Our problem is, and the problem is with people who think they understand something of religion, that they want to put their own conceptions on God. They think that God is their servant. They are brought up with this conception that, oh God, you have to come and serve me. Oh God, I am having a problem, come and help me. Constantly, this kind of relationship is what goes on in most religions of the world. In fact, all religions of the world, except those that are following the teachings of Vedanta. Every other religion puts their own conception onto God, rather than honor that person as separate from this world, in his own right, to do whatever he wants to do. It's not up to us to dictate what God should or should not do. If I come to your house, for example, and you've painted the walls blue, and I say to you, but why didn't you paint them red? You know I love red. You say, well, mind your own business. This is my house, and I like it blue. This is God's world, and he likes it like this. And he does activities like this. It's not up for us to question what he does. This is man's limited intelligence to try and question what the Lord does. We should simply understand we are his servants and worship him. The sweetness that anyone experiences through worshiping an object is so profound and tasteful. Why would you want to have yourself as that worshipable object? You understand? You know, to be able to worship is a great gift that the Lord has given us. So in true worship, we put no boundaries on that person. So this apparent immoral love that the Lord experienced during his Krishna manifested pastimes 5,000 years ago is of the highest taste and sweetness. And this is what Mahaprabhu himself, Krishna, Mahaprabhu is totally Krishna himself, but he's come to taste his own sweetness. That is who is Mahaprabhu. If we try and understand these topics through the mood of affection, because the conclusion is only about affection, if we approach it with this way, then we can understand the topics. But we will never really understand these topics unless we take shelter of someone who already understands these topics, because that is the process. Only through Guru is it possible to understand these topics. Like Jesus Christ, for example, who was his guru? In what sampradaya or school was he? Jesus Christ was a great lover of God. Christ means Krishna. Christ in Greek is Christos, in Latin it's Christa, in Sanskrit it's Krishna, Jesus the son of Krishna. But at most, he did not teach the intimacy of relationship with God, because it's not described who that guru was that could teach Jesus that. He taught about love in this world. He taught about morality in this world. And the conception of God that he left, because there are two sorts of Christians. There are the fundamental Christians who do the ritual and hope that Supreme Lord will grace them with mercy. And this gives you a morally good life. But it's not really about God. It's really about you being safe from all the fearful anomalies of this world. But then the second sort of Christian are the mystic Christians, like Thomas Merton, for example. Great Christian mystic, who I love personally. I read extensively all of his writings and teachings, and they're so beautiful. But his ultimate conception of the Supreme is only one of imagination. He has no knowledge yet in that life of that person. He hasn't understood the personality of God in depth. Because if you understand the personality, there must be relationship there. He's worshipping that God as some great all-encompassing spirit, some great, even he may think, person, but he doesn't know the form of that person, what that person looks like. So in Sanskrit, this description is called Brahmavad. That means I'm worshipping the greatness of God with great happiness and joy, and I'm experiencing some mystic taste from that relish. Then we have Islam. We have Muhammad. He himself began in Mecca, then went to Medina, and he was almost like a warlord in Medina. He actually beheaded with his own hand 700-800 Jews in that city. So a mood of violence has always gone on in that particular religion. The Sufis, who are the more esoteric followers of that Allah, proclaim that God is all peaceful, all wonderful, all joy, etc. But they have no definition of his personal form. So it's again an impersonal conception. The great Rumi, the poet Rumi, is the person who described God in so many ways, but not in a personal form. His writings and teachings are so tasteful and enjoyable, just like Thomas Merton. They're so sweet for us to taste, but in the ultimate conclusion, they don't show who is God. What to speak of God's own relationships with his own close associates? That idea of love is lacking in the ultimate, because the individual wants something for himself. Again, the followers of Sufism want to taste some relish in sweetness. The followers of Thomas Merton, they want to experience some mystic wonderland. But it's not about service. It's devoid of that conception. It's like moksha or liberation. So again, they fall short of the ultimate sweet conclusion that Mahaprabhu came to give. And then Buddhism, of course, the Buddhist that is followed today is followers of the Singha Sakha Buddha, who came about 800 years before Christ. Shankaracharya came 800 years after Christ, AD, to counteract that Buddhist influence. So all of these teachings, all that what I've talked about, is to focus in and examine all the different aspects of religion and to ask actually what is the meaning of religion. Religion comes from the Latin word religio. Religio. Ligio means to connect, reconnect. Reconnect with the Supreme. You can reconnect with the Supreme in three different ways. Vedanti tat tattva vidas tattvam yajnanam advayam. Brahmati paramatmati bhagavan iti shabyate. There is connecting through the Brahman, through the light. This is like an impersonal connection. Then there is connection through the supersoul. This is closer, but still it's not completely personal. Then there is Bhagavan, that is completely personal, the Supreme Lord himself. We can understand this when we look at a candle. A candle has three parts to it. It has the beautiful glowing flame, the yellow and blue golden flame of the candle. That is like an object, that is like has form. And then it has the energy of the heat. That is like a secondary aspect of the candle. And then it has the radiance or the light. That is a third aspect of the candle. They're all the candle, but they're three different aspects of the one. So many of these different religions, they're all saying about the same God, but they're simply three different aspects of the same principle. Like the word Allah, it means light. But if you ask a Muslim, well, have you ever experienced a light without a source? Is there any such thing as light without having an object that is the source? Now we have the sunlight coming from the sun. If it was nighttime, we'd have the electric light coming from the light, etc. So there must be an object to the source of the light. So how can it be impersonal? How can there be no form? There must be form. We only have experience of form. The reason why we try to throw it into the impersonal conception is because we have come from an impersonal conception originally. When the jiva was in the body of Mahavishnu originally, he didn't want to go to Krishna and he didn't want to come to the material world. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur has described it as shantaras. We were in an impersonal state of consciousness. We didn't want to go up, but we're just like a stone, just like steady, just numb, impersonal. Then from that stage, we were thrown into the Tathashta, where we chose to come and exploit Krishna's energy. We were attracted to the light of this mayic world, this illusory world where I would be the controller. So I have a sanskar or an impression of that impersonal reality. I've already been there. I've never had an impression of my relationship with Krishna. I have never been to Krishna. I have never ever been with Krishna. I have experienced something of his potency, but I have never actually seen Krishna. If you saw Krishna, you would never look at anything else. We cannot understand this, because Krishna is as beautiful beyond our imagination. Krishna is that beautiful. We would never look to this darkness again if we had seen the beauty of that reality. So we have never ever been with Krishna. We came straight into this material world. There's three sorts of jiva. One that serves, coming from Baladev in Goloka Vrindavan. And they are eternally perfected personalities, nitya siddhas. And then there are those that come from Sankarshan in the Vaikuntha worlds. They are separate jivas and they serve Lakshmi Narayan eternally. And they're totally satisfied with that service mood. And then there is the service of the jiva. He serves this material energy. And we have never been in the spiritual world ever. So all of what I'm talking about is knowledge or gyan. The jiva is in ignorance, and unless he is purified with knowledge, he cannot understand that purest conception. And it's not that we should labor within this knowledge. We are not trying to be gyanis. We are not trying to be scholars at all. That is not our path in any way. Our path is to purify our misconceptions and then come to the loving conclusion of my relationship with Radha and Krishna through service. And then I let go of all of this. All of what I said is actually unimportant in a sense. What is the essence is my relationship with Radha and Krishna through service. If you just serve prasadam, if you just dig in the garden and grow some flowers for Krishna, if you make a video for Krishna, if you do any sort of service, this is actually the highest conception.